Hi, welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yaakov David Cohen. I'm here with Rabbi David Edelman. Shalom, Rabbi Edelman, Avid Moyed.
Alechem Shalom to you, and good May, good Yahu.
And today we're going to talk about Rabbi Edelman is a shliach of the Rebbe, of the previous Rebbe, from 1940s, originally from...
44.
From 1944.
I started in 44.
Okay, and originally from...
Baltimore.
Baltimore, Maryland. Rabbi Edelman, would you like to tell us
I'd like to tell a story about my father-in-law, Rabbi Yaakov Yerzuber, one of the original Tamimim, who was the chief rabbi of Sweden during the war. And he came to Boston to help the yeshiva out. At that time, the president of the yeshiva was a wonderful Fum Balabos named Yom Tov Priluk, who lived in Canton, about 10 miles outside of Boston. And he told my father-in-law a story about his family. So my father-in-law said to him, I want you to go with me. Come to New York. We'll go to the former Rebbe. We'll get a bracha. And I want the Rebbe to hear this story from you direct. Direct from you. That's how impressed he was. So he went to New York and he told the Rebbe the story. Later on, I said to him, Mr. Priluk, I want to hear the story from you. This is the story. And then we davened a little with them, and then we told them about this greatness of Shabbat, because of being a Jew, and how wonderful that is, and everything else. We spent the whole Shabbat with them. And they had such an impact on them. From these 39 students, four of them got smicha later on. It's the kid learning. And from the girl, some are shluchim today.
This is all from...
Yeah, all from... You know, so we saw it's not enough to have 1 hour a week, so we have to buy a piece of land on the college campus in Amherst. This is the first step in the United States on the campus. But Amherst was not a very Jewish city. In fact, they said they don't allow Jews in the city. So he wrote to the Rebbe. The Rebbe said, go ahead. So he said, go see the attorney, real estate guy Jones. If you buy from him, he'll sell you. And we found a place on the campus from a retired professor. Gorgeous, beautiful home. And he worked 30 years on this garden. He was a good guy. And we bought, they went to $90,000.
This is what year?
In 19, that must have been in the 70s.
Right, okay.
Now, it was a lot of money then. So Zalman Deitch, my son-in-law, saw the importance of this. He says he'll give $10,000. We took Rabbi Darren out and his wife, and they were rented a little teeny house until we got this place. So we went to New York, Rabbi Darren and I. And I said, let's go to Zalman's mother. She's the secretary of the business. She writes the checks. That's her money. We have to let her know what we're doing. It's not nice just to tell her. So we went to her house, and she was a real Chassidish woman. And we told her we're buying a place in Amherst, and your son Zalman helped us very much, and he gave us a check. So she says, how much did he give? So we said $10,000. So she says, hey, Bazay, if that's the case, I'll also do the same.
Wow.
She said, so we had $20,000, and I went into Springfield, and there was a man, Jack Popkin, whose very essence was giving. I never saw my life. He just gave. Anything came across, 90% of all of the giving were Jewish causes. No. And he would treat me like a tate. So I said, Jack, we're buying a place there. We need some help. And so I said, Chabad house. He never heard the word. It was not popular to them. So there was another guy, a tall kid, 6 foot tall, a student. I don't know till this day what he was doing there. He says, Jack, he's talking about a Chabad house. I know what that is. I live in L.A. And I go to a Chabad house there. They're wonderful. The student is tremendous. Oh, if that's the case, says, I'll also give 10.
Yeah.
Just like that.
and we bought the Chabad house through Jonesy. This guy Jones got us, but you had to get the mortgage also through him.
All right.
And we moved in there, and they had tremendous success. Tremendous success at the beginning. Tremendous, especially Mr. Darren with the girls. The bench lift and everything else. Ah, they ate up every word you had to say.
And it's still there.
Yeah, still is, yeah. And then it's being saved all that to this day. And there's a Rabbi Chaim Edelman with an A.
Yeah.
He runs it very good. He enlarged the building now. And he made a shul, a mikveh, and classrooms. And he has 7-8 rooms for students to sleep. It's a very beautiful Chabad house there.
Well, we have to go up and see it.
Yeah. And what does the body say? It's locked in. Jay says, I got to go to sleep, I'm tired. What does the godly soul can do in those hours? The godly soul never gets tired and never has to go to sleep. Right. But it's called locked in jail. The godly soul wants to do something, the body says, I have to eat. I got to do this. I got a job. I got to support a family. So, although the godly soul is locked in the body, God chose in his godliness that these two should be together. And the purpose of the soul coming down, Yerida Tzachali, you got to go even higher. And by having the Torah as a guideline, you do it. And the Nefesh HaLakis benches Gemel. It reaches its success. You bench Gemel when you arrive safely, and the Nefesh HaKis benches Gemel because it has arrived. So the Rebbe gave so much enthusiasm, so much strength, and so much goal for every single person that you have arrived. It was tremendous, the end of that Sefer. That was the Rebbe's first year.
And the Rebbe took a personal interest in what was going on?
Yes, the Friedrich Rebbe made him in charge of Merkos L'Inyan Chinuch. The Merkos was in charge of the entire outreach to reach every single Jew possible. They had that the Wednesday hour.
I think the famous line that the previous Rebbe said when he came to America is America is nishtandish.
That's right.
America is no different. That
they told the Rebbe, you can't do things of spreading Judaism here that they did in Europe, because America is different. So the Rebbe said, America is nitan, America is not different. The neshama is the same, the Torah is the same, and the God is the same. You can do it, you just got to do the right things. That's impossible, rest stop, you just came from Europe. The Rebbe said, no. The Rebbe, the first day he came at the boat, a tremendous amount of people came to meet the Rebbe's boat. They built special wooden platforms for dignitaries. It came to presidents and some from Washington, the governor from Albany, and big rabbis came, and politicians, and they all thanked God that the Rebbe arrived safely. So the Rebbe said, thank you very much. I didn't come here for my personal safety. If the Almighty wanted I should remain alive, He has enough angels to take care of me any place in the world. If I came here, it's for continue my life's work. I'm not going to go to sleep tonight unless I know there's a Temcha Tamim in Yeshiva tomorrow morning. And there was. The next morning, 12 students showed up in the Lubavitch Yeshiva in the East, East New York.
You were one of them?
No, I didn't come to the next year.
Kolodny, I think my brother's father was one of them.
Kolodny was there. Benetsky,
yeah.
The Hecht were there. Von Hecht, and they had 7 boys who had been to Atwas, who went to Europe before the war. Yeah, Levy was there too, Brother Levy. And those 7 surely were there, and other 5, and they started. That's what the Rebbe wanted. Now, the Heintinger Rebbe, we took it to America. This reach, the yeshiva, is for the students that are learning. But the Rebbe wanted each and every Jew, no one left behind. that slogan, no Jew, no child left behind, was taken by American presidents also to educate every child. The Wednesday hour, 1 hour we took public school kids. All of a sudden we were reaching thousands of children every week and telling them there's a Yom Tov coming. Tell them there's a Shabbos each week. Give them a little slip of paper that tell their mother they should light candles at this time. Came Pesach, whatever the Yom Tov did, the children had no idea. They never attended any Hebrew school. So the Rebbe was able to reach in one blow thousands of children. Thousands of children. And everything that America did, and also part of the Americas was printing literature in English, because the majority of the people in this country only understood English. The scholars tell us that 90% of all the knowledge that a person receives is through the written, printed word. So the Rebbe understood that. A lot of things came out in Yiddish. The Sikhs, the Rebbes, and the talks for Yontif, and also came in Hebrew for the Israelis. And for America, came in English. Talks and Tales, he started a magazine just for children. Just for children. And you should know what's going on in the world, the beauty of a mitzvah. The wonderful thing when you help another Jew. Avos Yisrael. The Rebbe had a magazine for the general public called Akriya V'Akdusha. The Rebbe had twice a week a column in the newspaper. Beautiful stories.
The former Rebbe.
And right behind him was the present Rebbe, strengthening and broadening out everything what Lubavitch wanted. The goals of Lubavitch were to reach every other Jew. Because Avas Yisrael, the Rebbe implanted in the heart of every Jew, every Shaliach, a love of another Jew. Love of another Jew is not new, it's in the Torah. It says, V'havta l'recha kamecha. It's part of the Torah, love another Jew like yourself. It means not only you have to help him if he's hungry, you give him to eat. If you have no place to sleep, you give him lodging. Physical hunger you have to take care of, but it also means spiritual hunger. If they never were ever to learn how to daven or do any mitzvah or knowledge of God, you have to teach them. No difference between spiritual poverty or physical poverty. They're all in the mitzvah that God sent. And that has been the watchword and the goal of all the Rebbes. Started from Tanya in chapter 32, which means Lev, the heart, teaches us how to love another Jew. And the Heintige Rebbe really expanded that, especially through all the shluchim, all the schools, all the people that he reaches. And I hope and pray that this is the holiday of Sukkot, which is the holiday that the Rebbe writes again and again, that binds us together as one, in the Sukkah as one. And Esrog and the Lulav, all the four things they have a connection with binding together, keeping the Jews together, keeping them strong. And that will truly bring the great strength of the nation, the strength of our country Israel, and the strength of Kambi Mashiach with the Rebbe Tzidkenu speedily in our time.
And Shkoyach, thank you, Bob. The Rebbe also outreach not only for Jewish people, but also in the late years about the Sheva Mitzvahs Bnei Noach.
Yes.
And he also had a message, a universal message to all people, that the Torah is... You know.
The Rambam writes that just like we have 614 mitzvahs commanded by the Torah, there are seven mitzvahs called Noahide laws that the Jews are commanded to see that the world observes them. So the Rambam says, if you live in a country where they won't persecute you for telling them there's the seven mitzvahs of Noah, you should do it. And that's why we spread that among the non-Jewish population. And they love it. They absolutely love it. We have a doctor, a Frum doctor, who had in my town, had a goyish neighbor, an engineer. And they were talking one night when he came home from work. It was later at night. So the Jewish doctor said to him, "I'm sorry, I have to go home now because my rabbi is going to speak tonight on television." No. He meets him the next day. So the Goyish neighbor said, "You know what? I learned something great." "What do you mean?" He says, "After you went away, I went home, turned on television. There's nothing to see of interest. I kept turning and turning, and then I saw a picture of a rabbi. Ah, that's that. Must be my neighbor's rabbi. I'm going to listen." And he says, "I never knew that I get such a great reward from obeying the Noahide laws. If one day goes by, I don't steal, I don't know. I get a, for every single day, I get a reward. I obeyed that negative law. I feel so good." Now, it's accepted. This truth is so universal, it's accepted by everybody. And the Jews have a responsibility to see to it that the non-Jewish population keeps the seven mitzvahs of Bnei Noach. And it really, really spread out well. When I went to build the new building, we had a little fire in the old one. And the Rebbe directed me every single moment of the way.
What year?
This is 1980.
Yeah.
So, and at the end, we could not get a building permit because we were the first building on that block. And they said, "Don't go to the commissioner. He's the toughest in the world. No one ever gets anything from him." So we're stuck with a beautiful piece of land and a sign, future home. So I went to the Rebbe, "What should I do?" The Rebbe said, "Don't worry." I come back, it was 2 o'clock in the morning. I come back to Springfield, 8, 9 in the morning, and I go in front of my land, watching the trees, and a car pulls behind me, and a man comes out, and he said to me, "Are you Rabbi Edelman?" I said, "Yeah." He says, "I'm Mr. Clark, the building commissioner. I got all the permits for you. You can start tomorrow." And he really, really worked hard. So I said to him, "Why did you do it, mister? Thank you very much. Why did you do this?" He said, "The children that will attend your school will be God-fearing children. That is the future of our community, not the public school kids. That's why I did it." So I just showed you how these seven mitzvahs of the Noahide laws has an effect on the general population. It was a very big thing.
There's a story also you mentioned once about that you were having trouble selling your house, and the Rebbe told you, "Don't worry," you came back with the building.
That happened way back in 1950 when I came.
You came to Springfield, Massachusetts.
I came to Massachusetts, and the yeshiva was in a one little family house. Little teeny house. So I said, "Yeshiva can't grow there." So I went right away. I was there maybe a month or 2 months. And I put a down payment on a beautiful, beautiful, stately home on the main drag. And I put $300 down, and I'll sell the old one, and the difference will be a mortgage or move in. Excuse me. A month goes by, I haven't sold it. And I'm worried I'm going to lose my down payment. So I get in my car, go to New York, and those days before the turnpikes, it took 4 hours, and I didn't get into the Rebbe till very late at night, 3 o'clock in the morning. And the Rebbe, it's a Tov Shin Yud.
1950,
a few months after Yud-Shvat. So I told the Rebbe my problem, I'll lose my down payment. So the Rebbe said, "Tell them to wait. Zog zem zem warten."
Tell who to wait?
The people that I'm put the down payment to buy the new one. Right. After 30 days, they can throw me out and get somebody else.
Right.
So the Rebbe said, "Tell them to wait." And as far as selling your old building, so I said to the Rebbe, "We have a problem." Before I get a chance to tell, the problem was we couldn't sell it. The realtor said, "That house is next door to a gasoline station. No bank gives a mortgage on a house next to a gas station for two reasons. Number one, the main one, it's dangerous. And number two, the odor is terrible." So the bank, a poor bank can't buy it because he can't get a mortgage. A rich person would not buy it for the same reason that the bank didn't want it. Impossible to sell it. So I went to the Rebbe. I said, we're having a problem selling the old place. And I went to tell the Rebbe the reason. The Rebbe lifted up his hand, like, no problem. No problem. I get in my car, travel all night long, and I came into Springfield 8 o'clock in the morning. I drive over to my little house there, and right on the porch is a lady with cash. Lady with cash. The Rebbe gave me the bracha, so I knew something's happening here. So I said to the lady, how did you know that this house is for sale? There was no sign. She says, I heard. How'd you hear? So I said to you, know, I'd like to show you the inside of this little house, but I don't have a key because I am new here. But it just about 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock, the janitor comes, and there's a station wagon right in the driveway, and he takes the station wagon, and he picks up the children, and he opens up the building. So if you wait a minute, I'll show you the inside. She said, that's okay, I don't mind. I said to the lady, I have to tell you, there used to be a kitchen downstairs. No more. They made it over for bathrooms for the children. There's no kitchen there at all. She says, okay, my father-in-law, he'll take care of it. No more. When I told her how the miscoming, the shortcoming, she didn't want to hear. She said, my father-in-law, I come from Chicago, and my husband was visiting there, and we met, and we got married. We came here, so my father-in-law built a house in Deerfield Lane, outside of the city. And I'm stuck there. I don't even have a car. I don't drive. Come the winter, all together with the snow. There's not even a bus there. Can't live there. I want to live here. So I said, see, over there, I have no shul. There's no kosher market. And there's nothing Jewish around there. No shul, nothing market. Here, where this little house is, there are two kosher markets and the shul. I have everything I need. And the kosher butcher also. That's why I bought it. Ah. That started the series of miracles that the Rebbe did for us from that moment on till today.
We built buildings and...
Yeah, we built a lot of buildings, and now we have a beautiful campus in a new section of the city with the basketball field, everything. It's a beautiful, beautiful school there, and thank God the school's growing, and we have a beautiful staff of teachers, and with God's help and the Rebbe's bracha, it'll continue growing.
And learning Torah and every day.
Yeah. Classes for adults, special classes for the people who came from Russia. You have every sitter with a translation of Russian, every Mazel with Russian. We make a special Seder night in Russian. Hanukkah also, we have a special night for the Russian. They bring their children, they bring their parents.
And
we take good care of them.
And this has been going on for over 62 years.
Yep, the yeshiva started in 1944. 44. Gabby Gordon, and I came in 1950.
Wow, going over 70 years.
Yeah.
Any interesting stories of the students that come by again in the teacher?
Yeah, very, very. They come down now. We have now grandchildren from the original children who attend the school. And the acceptance of the whole city accepted the yeshiva tremendous. The good name it has.
All started in 1944.
We have a lot of doctors and lawyers, a lot of real professionals who came out from the school.
And they all study Torah, and they appreciate the heritage, the Jewish heritage.
Sure they do.
And the Torah. That's amazing. It's amazing to talk, to have the opportunity to talk to a pioneer, a chassid like yourself. Be able to hear it firsthand. This is going to be, and I want to thank you for your time, for your effort, for all your Sukkot is, like you say, it's uniting all types of Jews. The Jewish people, regardless of their affiliation, a Jew is a Jew, meaning that every Jew has the Torah given to him, regardless whether he's a great scholar or he knows very little bit. And today with the internet, and it's very easy to study. Anyone could pick up the Torah and study the weekly portion, Hasidus, and so on.
Yeah, there's certain things we do, like Shmura Matzah. We give out the whole city. We bring in, for Springfield alone, over 400 pounds of matzah. And there's almost every single Jew in the whole city has Shmura Matzah. At least I know they have matzah in their house. We go in there, we got days assigned Mechilos Chometz, and we take care of them. Chanukah, the candles of the whole city
is illuminated with light.
Yeah, everybody, the city hall has a city, has a Nehru's Chanukah, and they come down, the mayor and everybody else. The whole city knows that Chanukah is here.
Sukkot is
here. At Chicken Lula, we go around to everybody we can find, up and down the business offices and everywhere. We venture people. Strengthen their identity.
From this, we'll bring about the Mashiach, because that's the ultimate, where the whole world will see godliness and see Hashem, and everyone will come to realize Hashem is like the, I think that was the mission statement of the Rebbe when he took when he became Rebbe, that he's the seventh in the line, and that Chol Hashvim Chavivim, and ultimately this is all to bring about Mashiach.
Amen.
I want to thank you,
Rabbi Edelman. Thank you, Rabbi Cohen.
Thank you.
It's cute.
Wow.